Welcome to Padre's Corner. I'm Father Robert Ballas here, the digital Jesuit. This is the show that's pretty much about anything I want it to be about. You see, we decided that we wanted something to give back to the chat room, something to reward them for sticking by us throughout the week of news and programming. So this is just the time to kick it with the good geeks and gals, the men and women of chat room. Now, the first story I want to talk about is, hey, Mosquito, guess what? It's official. No one likes you. This came to me from a little journal, and then they wrote about it in Geek. The idea is, well, everything in the bio system has some sort of purpose. It could be the most useless animal, the most useless insect, and we still find out that there's a use for them. You find out that honeybees, even though that they're small, if they were to disappear, it would essentially cause a mass extinction event. There would no longer be mass pollinization. We wouldn't have a food supply. We find out that things like algae and plankton are, even though microscopic, tiny little plants and animals, allow us to have a big old food chain that goes all the way back to us. And if they were to disappear again, mass extinction. This is pretty much the same for most animals. Even the vermin species, things like rats and cockroaches, provide biomass. They give us something to feed the food chain as it goes up. And ultimately, that's a good thing. Well, these researchers decided to do an in-depth study of the mosquito. What is it that the mosquito brings? And people for the longest time thought, hey, mosquitoes are annoying, but they probably provide something that's useful in the ecosystem. No, negative, In fact, they found out that it is a negligible impact on the biomass that's provided. Even species that eat mosquitoes, frogs and other insects that eat those mosquitoes and mosquito larvae, only use them as supplemental protein. That their diet would be perfectly fine and they'd be able to find other alternatives for that protein other than the mosquito. So truly, the mosquito is one of those animals that we just don't need. And how about that? We spent all that money and found out something that I probably could have told you. Mosquitoes are annoying. Now, how about this? You probably have a car, right? Well, if you don't have a car, you're probably hoping to get a car. Or if you're not hoping to get a car, you probably see people who are driving cars. Well, what if I told you that for $20 in parts, you could create a system that could take over the car? Now, I'm not talking about an advanced hack here. I'm not talking about rewiring anything. I'm talking about building a small device that you could plug into a onboard network that already exists and take over the car while it's in motion. Yeah, it sounds kind of terrifying. It sounds like science fiction, but it's real. The Register was reporting on a group of Spaniards who showed off a $20 set of components that could be used to gain wireless access to a car's control. Now, the unit uses the CAN. That's the Controller Area Network. Now, your car is basically a series of networked computers. The unit is able to connect to the CAN, and then it uses Bluetooth to connect to a mobile device. You can then use that mobile device to trigger the emergency brake, turn on and off the braking system and a steering assist, turn on and off the headlights, or play with the car's alarm. Now, right now, it's only Bluetooth, which means you have to be close to the car, but the researchers are working on a GSM model. That's actually pretty trivial. GSM modules are just a single chip. You slide in there, now you can have access to the cellular phone network. What that means is that someone gaining physical access to your car, being able to pop the hood, being able to access the diagnostic ports, could surreptitiously insert a little piece of tech that would allow them to mess with your car from anywhere in the globe, as long as there's cell service around your vehicle. That is a little scary. What makes it even scarier is that I looked at the project. I checked out the schematics because there's just a group that has actually made it available online. It's not hard to create. Because the CAN, the Controller Area Network, is a standard, people know how to access it. So this is essentially just a bridge between either a Bluetooth network or the internet and your car. I think we're going to start to see more and more of these types of hacks as we progress with the Internet of Things. As we expect more of our devices to be able to talk to other devices, well, the necessary drawback to that is that these devices are eventually going to be able to be hacked remotely. And sad trombone. Now, I know this next story is probably going to take a few of you the wrong way, and that is all about the Doge. That's right. People over at NVIDIA have been working really, really hard because ATI has sort of owned the hashing crown. If you've done any sort of crypto mining that's not Bitcoin, you're going to find out that AMD parts right now have a super huge performance benefit over NVIDIA parts. And that's just because the way that they're constructed, the way that they're built, the way that they're designed, they are much better at doing the algorithms that are required for the proof of work that can unlock a blockchain. In other words, earn you Doge, earn you Litecoin. Well, NVIDIA for the longest time has been on the bad side of that performance stick. Cards like this, although pretty damn good for gaming, have been horrible for the price performance, price per watt performance of mining. They're just not very good at it. I could take a five-year-old AMD card and probably get better performance than a higher-end NVIDIA. Well, that's no longer the case. NVIDIA's new series of GPUs, according to Tom's Hardware, are much, much faster and much, much more efficient. Now, what does that mean? Well, when we look at any sort of crypto mining, it's not just the raw power. It's how many hashes, how many million hashes, how many kill hashes, thousands of hashes can you do every second per watt? You want to know how much power it's going to use, because ultimately that will determine whether or not it's going to be economical for you to mine. If you could mine a million Doge every second, but it's going to cost you $100,000, that's not real good. What NVIDIA's new cards, and that's specifically their NVIDIA GeForce GTX 750 Ti series, can do is it can give you a 35% boost in performance for crypto hashing while at the same time reducing the amount of power that it takes. The bottom line is that they can now mine more efficiently than the ATI cards. Now, the ATI parts still have a performance boost. They can still mine much faster, but the GTX 750 Ti is actually a budget part. It's an economy part. And the thinking is that when NVIDIA releases their high-end, high-performance cards, we're going to be able to see a price-performance-watt ratio that's going to blow AMD out of the water. For all of us gamers, this is actually welcome news, because maybe it finally means that we can buy AMD cards for somewhere near their regular retail price. Now, I'm sorry, I hate to do this, but there's also a second Doge story here, and that is that, the Harvard supercomputer got owned. Now, owned is kind of a misnomer here, because it wasn't really owned. It was authorized access. What they found out through the Harvard Crimson student newspaper was that Harvard's Odyssey supercomputing cluster was hijacked for the purpose of mining Doge coins. Now, the purpose, either a faculty member or a staff person who had permission to use the system. So they were granted access, but they did not have permission to mine cryptocurrency. Anyone who's ever worked on a supercomputing cluster knows how this works. You don't just turn on the supercomputer and suddenly you have access to everything. You get a time slice. They say, okay, well, what are you doing? You know, this research requires this many CPUs, this many cores, this much of the resources that are available in the cluster. We'll give that to you for a time slice so that you can get your research done. Well, someone abused their privileges and used that time slice to mine Doge. Now, the Odyssey is a 4,096-core supercomputing cluster capable of 32.4 trillion floating-point operations per second. But here's the thing. That's actually not a lot of coin. It might have been a lot of coin in the old days of Bitcoin, because Bitcoin could be CPU mined. But the thing about Litecoin and Dogecoin, script-based crypto mining, and you go back to episode one of Padre's Corner, I gave a pretty detailed explanation of what script mining is. Those types of crypto mining are specifically designed to resist attempts to brute force them with CPU. You have to use a GPU, a graphics part, one of these things, because it's much better at doing the trillions of operations that you need to unlock a blockchain. Well, the short of that is that even if they had total control of all 4,096 CPUs, all the cores, all the Intel Xeon E5410 CPUs, with the amount of time that they had, they could maybe get 20 mega hash per second. That's 20 million hashes per second, which sounds like a lot. But I can build a custom rig with four AMD GPUs, and that would be worth somewhere between 4 and 6 million hash per second. So not a great, great thing if you've got a lot of CPUs. The other thing about that is they wouldn't have had access to the entire cluster. They would have had access to that small part, which means, womp womp, sad, sad trombone. Now, when we come back, I think it's time for a rant. I'm kind of feeling a rant building up in my soul about net neutrality and Comcast. But before we get there, I thought maybe we should listen to some very important words from our very own Ali Spagnola.
Bieber is a superhero, we know that. Perfect voice, perfect skin, perfect hair and laugh. Every superhero has an alter ego. Of course, average people from which our heroes morph. I'm here to tell you the truth finally. When Justin isn't Bieber, he changes back to me.
I'm Justin Bieber. His alter ego is me. What shall I make you believe?
Baby. See? You can't be that great all the time, nonstop, or this crappy. Sometimes you gotta swap. When I feel manly, this is what you see. My voice is pretty good, my smile's not dreamy. Then in a phone booth, brush my hair 100 times, put on a backwards hat, and kinda squint my eyes.
I'm Justin Bieber. His alter ego is me. Watch him, I'll make you believe.
See? Batman got Bruce Wayne, Superman, Clark Kent. When Justin disappears, this is where he went. Yeah, we screwed up a lot, but our name is overused. There was more important stuff that the world should call news. Stop being mean, think how hard that it would be if Super Bruce could not escape his mild-mannered me.
I'm Justin Bieber. His alter ego is me. Watch him, I'll make you believe.
See? One more secret and don't you dare discuss. Full moon nights are when I'm mad, I'm also Miley Cyrus.
Don't miss next week's most Googled song. Subscribe, come on!
Thanks to Ali Spags for letting us play her videos on the show. I always love her brand of humor. But you know what I don't find humorous? I don't find Monopoly's humorous. I don't find Comcast humorous. And I really don't find humorous when you have the U.S. public ripped off to the tune of a few $100 billion. Now, I know everyone's heard about the Comcast deal, that Comcast wants to buy Time Warner. And yeah, okay, we'll talk about that later on. But the story actually starts way before that. It goes before the FCC guidelines on net neutrality were struck down by the Supreme Court. It goes back before the FCC even wrote those guidelines. In fact, it goes back even before we knew what net neutrality was. You see, this story really started after the 1986 Telecommunications Act, when we started looking at what the country was going to need in order to build out its infrastructure. And there is a very little known story about how the public got bilked. Yeah, that's right. I'm going to say it. Bilked for billions of dollars. I remember the story from when I was living in San Jose. It was an iCringely article that I had read. And then I started doing a little bit of a research project on exactly how much of this was true. So let me give you the bullet points. Between 1994 and 2004, the major telcos were the beneficiaries of higher phone rates. And the reason why these higher phone rates were allowed was because they had promised the FCC, they had promised Congress, they had promised us that they wanted to develop and deliver a next-generation high-speed network. Well, what does that mean? Well, unfortunately, we didn't clarify it that much. We gave them a lot of money without ever specifically saying, okay, this is what we want. But here's what they had promised. The Telecommunications Act of 1996 was supposed to deliver high-speed fiber coax hybrid networks that could bring 45 megabits per second bidirectional service to 86 million homes spread across all 50 states and D.C. by the year 2006. Now, 51 plans were made that would do this, that would allow us to run out broadband to those 86 million people, and all 51 plans failed. Now, why did those plans fail? There's a lot of rumor, there's a lot of innuendo, but what we know for sure is that nothing like that was ever delivered. Now, in the related FCC filings, it was estimated that it cost close to $2,000 per household, and yet we got very little. And the way that they get at this price is that they say, okay, well, what were the tax breaks that were given to the telcos? What was the preferential option that was given to telcos for certain routes and the right of way? What were the rates that we allowed over the years because we thought the telcos were going to use that money to build out that network? Because remember, the telcos were under a mandate to make sure that they got connectivity, phone service to all rural areas. This was supposedly just an expansion of that project. Well, in 2006, the telcos came back to the FCC, back to Congress, and they said, yeah, well, we promised you that we were going to have a high-speed network for 86 million people that would do 45 megabits per second. But we ran into a couple of difficulties. So instead, we're going to provide 20 million Americans with 1.5 megabit per second asymmetrical DSL. And that's it. No, seriously, that's it. No, we stopped there. That's where the story stops for the telcos. They took the $200 billion and they gave us, well, crap. They gave us nothing. They gave us horrible, horrible service that doesn't compete with anything. Remember that this bill was supposed to spur competition. The idea was the FCC thought if we could get a couple of players out there, have the cable companies, have the telcos, have them duke it out, then we could get high-speed networks and the consumers could get low costs for their service. Well, we know that that hasn't happened because unless you live in a really super special place, you probably only have one, maybe two players for broadband. And one of those players is probably DSL, so it's not really broadband. Again, sad, sad trombone. So now that brings us up to today. Today we have Comcast intending to buy Time Warner Cable. Well, what does this mean? I know there's been a lot of discussion about this, but most of the discussion has been about the ramifications in the courtroom. Is this going to be allowed? Will it be legal? Will they actually let Comcast complete its merger? Well, there's another part, and that is, well, what happens to that $200 billion? Do we write it off? Do we hold the telcos accountable? Do we say, if you want further public funds, if you want further public trust, if you want those right-of-ways that let you build up these monopolies, well, guess what? We're going to demand something in writing. That's kind of what they're trying to do. When the Comcast deal, they have promised to sell cable systems serving about 3 million subscribers so that its national footprint does not exceed 30% of the country. Now, that's so that they can keep below that threshold saying, well, look, yeah, we'll be more powerful. We'll have access to the New York markets, but we're going to sell off 3 million of our customers to another cable system, and that should make everything okay. The difficulty in that is just selling off those customers does not negate the impact of the Time Warner deal. See, what Comcast is doing is they're building up a big enough backbone where they could throttle, where they could change performance of competing services without ever really violating any mandate, even if the FCC were able to still rewrite the net neutrality guidelines. That's because the guidelines only apply to actively throttling content from your competitors. But what Comcast could do, regardless of any FCC guidelines, is to not properly negotiate their peering arrangements. Meaning that if you were on the Comcast network, it's not that they're slowing you down, it's just that they didn't really put enough thought, enough equipment, and enough upgrade capacity into their peering arrangements with other networks to make sure that your Netflix arrives on time, that your Hulu arrives on time. However, since Comcast owns NBC, you can bet that all of those NBC services and on-demand content will arrive in a timely fashion. This is sort of the national nightmare of broadband, something that was kicked off all those years ago when we decided to write a check for $200 billion and say, well, you're going to do okay by us, right? 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 Now, who knows? I think that's the end of the rant. Now, speaking of the end of the rant, I want to welcome to the show someone who you probably know. You know him. You love him. He's Mr. Lou Maresca. Lou, thank you for coming on. Welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me, Padre. It's been a great night so far. Friday night, baby.
Friday night. Now, tell me about your Friday night. What does your Friday night normally consist of?
Work, 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 and some more work.
Okay, that sounds kind of depressing. Not only does it sound kind of depressing, it sounds a little bit like what
it's pretty depressing. Yeah,
I do. That's
add some Xbox into there, and in between there, here and there.
About that. Okay. Well, Lou, I was thinking that maybe we could take a little stroll along some of the hot topics of the day. Some of the things that have flashed through my mind. What do you think?
Let's do it.
Let's do it. Now, the first little story here is all about Amazon upping its content game. Have you heard about the story at all?
Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So the idea is, if you remember a while back, Amazon decided to go the way of Netflix and create some, pilots. They wanted to create some shows that people would be able to vote on what you wanted. And so they had a pilot season, and people wanted to keep Betas, which was a show actually that I follow, And I believe the other one was called Alpha House, which is sort of a political thriller. Now, it's not just pilots. They've also gone ahead and ordered some shows from other networks. They've taken, what, The Americans, The League, Louie, How I Met Your Mother, It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, and Archer from different networks and put it into their Prime offerings. Now, Amazon is doing this pilot season right now with about 10 shows, some kids shows, some adult shows, including things like The After and Bosch, among others. But the interesting story here is how different this is from Netflix. See, when Netflix did their original series, they decided that they were going to find one or two really good talents, really good actors, throw money at them and say, make us House of Cards, make us Lilyhammer, make us Orange is the New Black, and it's going to be an exclusive. It looks like what Amazon is doing is they're saying, we're going to shotgun a bunch of stuff. We're going to see what you like, and then we're going to produce the things that you want us to do. Where do you fall? Which idea would you use if you were in charge of one of these content makers?
So I think Amazon's doing it right. I mean, they did this Amazon Studios thing where they were getting like 20,000 scripts. And they were, you know, thinking about maybe producing some of these things and coming out with some of these things, but they really haven't done too much with that at all. And it wasn't really, I'm not sure if it wasn't doing anything for them or what was going on, but I think this is doing it the right way. It's just, if you have the money to do it, you have the capital. Like, Netflix doesn't necessarily have the capital to do all this. They're in debt doing this. And I think since Amazon has the capital, the cash to do it, they just find some of the best directors and some of the best actors out there and put all the chips on them and make sure that they make some good content. I mean, obviously, if they have good track records, they're going to make some good content. And if they can do it in multiple different tiers and verticals, like children's shows and adult content and mystery and all this stuff, then that's the way to go to get yourself in the door, I think.
It's interesting that you mentioned verticals, because I think that's actually something that's been really big and on the mind of a lot of these content creators, which is, it's no longer just enough to make the content. You want to own the content. You want to own the delivery of the content. You want to own a subscriber base that you can do discovery for other pieces of content. And it looks like that's the secret sauce, right? I mean, that's the thing that they want now. Amazon knows that they've got a captive audience with Prime. And they know that Prime's going to become a premium service, right? I mean, we talked about this a while back, how Amazon's probably going to jack up the price of Prime by $50 or so. People are still going to get it, and because what they're going to get is not just that two-day service, but they get access to something that's growing, Amazon's content services. So here's the other question. I want to pick your brain, because you kind of work at one of the big ones, and that is, when you think about Apple, when you think about Microsoft, when you think about the traditional old-school players in the technology market, how are they going to do their vertical? How is Microsoft going to leverage the fact that it owns 90% of the desktops in the world, that it has such a huge footprint and could become a crazy player in content and delivery?
But I honestly don't know how they're going to get, I mean, Amazon's been doing it slowly, right? They've been kind of slowly creeping into the content business, and no one's really considered them a true player until just recently. But none of these companies, like Apple does horrible services. I mean, they don't do services right at all. And I don't know how, I mean, they have iTunes, obviously. People use it. They're expensive even. And they're not really getting out there, and a lot of people are using it. They're more using Netflix and other things. Microsoft is, it would be a new player. I think obviously you have Xbox Music and Xbox Entertainment. And I think they're doing a really good job there, really high quality stuff. And with the Xbox in the living room, they're getting that out there. But again, I'm not necessarily sure how they're going to get to people who have PCs. Obviously, maybe through the Windows 8, maybe some Windows Store apps, some Xbox apps on the actual devices. But I mean, they need to get closer. I think they need to push a little harder and put a little bit more money onto it and see if they can get into the living room even more so and onto the PCs. And like, I think what one of these articles said was talking about how they had gotten rid of their TV and all they use is these services, these content services. And you know, I kind of agree with that in a little sense. In some sense, I think about the normal nucleus family of still kind of surrounding the TV at night and watching something good. And I think that's still there and that still thrives. And I think if you can get yourself into the living room, like Amazon's doing, Netflix has done, it's super important to kind of get yourself out there for content-wise.
Now, here's something I want to throw into the mix. Just recently, Google announced that they are crazy expanding Google Fiber. I mean, they're coming to a lot of cities, 20 different cities, including some big ones like San Jose, you know, just down the road. And I have to admit, when they made the announcement, I started thinking, how long would the commute be from San Jose to Petaluma? I honestly was like, it might be worth an extra 2 hours a day if it meant that when I was at home, I had that blazing, crazy, ridiculous, oh my holy Lord, fast connection. But then I had to ask, well, when you look at something like Google, which is building out this network, which, again, it doesn't seem to be a publicity stunt anymore. It's not just a disruptive thing. They're actively building out a network that's going to rival. In fact, I think have more fiber in the ground than any of the major telcos. Isn't that the new model? If you've got the money, if you're an Apple, if you're a Microsoft, and you've got those billions in the bank, do you just say, hey, you know what? We're going to become a network because that's where the money is, because the content is there, because iTunes has proven that, yeah, that's where you're going to make your money. It's not going to be in the hardware. It's going to be in the sale, in the services, and in the product.
Yeah, I think, I mean, especially these big networks, they're still holding on to these cable companies saying, you know, we're going to hold on to these guys and hopefully they'll continue to provide content. But like you said, once these companies have large pockets, like deep pockets like they do, and they're putting their own networks out there. I mean, if Google keeps going, I mean, they could pretty much dominate when it comes to, you know, content and maybe even sell some of that content capabilities, that open stop type things, to things like Amazon to provide that content too. So, I mean, I think that's where the future is going, and cloud services is going to be even bigger than, you know, these content providers that are these cable services they're doing today, and they're holding themselves back. I mean, providing cable boxes that you can talk to is not going to really get you there where you need to go, I think, in the future here.
Yeah, I think you're right. All right, let's get off that, because I don't want to beat up too much on companies for not being Google. I mean, that's not a constructive
sure.
argument. Let's instead talk a little bit about, oh, I don't know, how about let's talk about Apple. Let's talk about Tim Cook. Now, just recently, 2 weeks ago, Tim Cook announced a $2 billion buyback. $14 billion buyback. This partially made Carl Icahn happy. He wanted a $50 billion buyback because, of course, he wanted to make his money. He's bought a lot of stock in Apple, and he thought that he should get paid for taking that position. Now, in this position of buying back, it was also announced that, Apple is going to be looking at aggressive moves. They've bought 21 different companies over the last couple of months. They're getting aggressive. And Tim Cook calls it aggressive in product categories and in their product development and in trying to reach new markets. My question is this. I know that this is a bad juju. You don't want to say, oh, well, you know, back in the day. But back in the day, with Steve Jobs, there never would have been a stock buyback. In fact, I believe Steve Jobs was once quoted as saying, look, if you own Apple, it means you believe in Apple. If you want your money, sell your stock. Get out of it. You know, we want the people who want to be owners of Apple. We want the people who want to be on board. Maybe it's me. I mean, because I haven't been the biggest fan of Apple, but maybe it's me thinking something's different, right? I mean, there's not that magic there used to be of saying, we're Apple and you pay us to be part of this experience, not the other way around. It's not, we don't owe you anything as a stock owner, except the fact that we make great product that should be accepted by the markets.
I think Steve Jobs' culture that he created was that he didn't really necessarily always listen to customers. He kind of told them what they are going to like and what they're going to need. And that's, a lot of companies have tried this and they've kind of failed. And I think Tim Cook is not aggressively doing that at all. I mean, what he's doing is, I mean, if you look at the list of companies that they've bought in the last year, things like Wi-Fi Slam, like the indoor location stuff, or was a queue for your personal assistant that pulls your online accounts and pulls data about your day. I mean, these things are just not useful things they're going to be really using too much about in their services at all. I mean, they're going to need to push more hard on services. I mean, these are just things. I mean, the buyback alone is something that Steve Jobs would have never done. You know, and if you talk about being aggressive, have you ever been in a room with Tim Cook? I mean, I've actually seen him speak before. I mean, being in the room with Bill Gates or Steve Ballmer or Steve Jobs, those type of guys, I mean, from a personal standpoint, he's definitely not aggressive. But I mean, from a product standpoint, he's not aggressive either. He hasn't really come out with anything that's really innovative in any kind of product vertical at all anywhere. I mean, he's not really done anything. If you think about from what Steve Jobs did with Apple, he's not done. Maybe it's his time. I don't know, but I haven't seen anything yet.
Yeah, I remember the announcement of the Mac Pro. And again, I think the Mac Pro is, it's a beautiful piece of kit. We've got one here. It is a great machine. It's fast. It's lovely. It's beautifully designed. Well, when they brought it out and then they did that whole, can't innovate my ass. Ha ha ha. Chuckle, chuckle, chuckle. Everyone's applauding. I'm thinking, no, that's not innovation. That's a repackaging. It's nice, but that's not innovation.
That's right.
You had innovation before. You were very
innovative. That's kind of what Apple does, is it picks a product. And I mean, the tablet wasn't new, but they made it the best they could, and other companies followed. And same thing with the phone. It wasn't new. They made something new and awesome, and it became the best. And then, you know, people followed, like other companies have followed. I mean, that's kind of like the track record Apple's had up until this point. And they're not really showing that. I mean, making something that looks like a trash can and calling it a computer, an innovation is not really going to, you know, do it over for customers. So I don't know. I mean, I guess I'm hoping that he has something in his back pocket, like the Apple TV or something, you know, Apple TVs or something. I don't know.
Yeah. And okay, first of all, let's make a disclaimer. Yes, Lou works for Microsoft, and I tend to use Microsoft products, but both of us own Apple products. Both of us have right. MacBooks. Both of us have iPads. Both right. of us have Apple TVs. We use Apple products, right? I mean, it's so we're very product agnostic. Right. What I'm seeing is the thing that made Apple so much money half a decade ago, they're not doing anymore. And there's actually a really good comment in the chat room from Joe Interwebs, who says, if it were feasible, Apple should become a private company. And we joke about, they're like, oh, yeah. But think about that. If Apple were a private company, if they were not beholden to stockholders, if they were able to do a buyback, a complete buyback, and say, you know what, we don't answer to anyone but ourselves now. We, the board owns Apple. The customers are the ones who decide what we're going to do. We don't have to improve profit quarter over quarter. We don't have to care about profit. All we have to care about is we're designing product that we're actually proud of, that we want to release into the wild. That's kind of the old Apple, right?
Yeah, I mean, Dell's doing it. I mean, that's really kind of where they're going too. I think that's kind of the key, is a lot of these companies, especially consumer electronic companies. I mean, Sony's having the same problem, is they push to make sure shareholders are happy, and they do things that are kind of like with the flow rather than being innovative and taking the risks. And I think that, yeah, I definitely think making themselves private again might bring them back to their roots.
Yeah, I kind of like that idea. I mean, there is something that's really corrupting about the stock market, about an IPO. And I think Steve Jobs had a big enough personality to buffet it, to say, I don't care if the market drops 400 points. Yeah, I don't care if Apple stock is $1 or $1,000. All I care about is my product. I'm making this is my art. And you're going to buy my art, whether or not a stock market cares about it. But what right. we've seen now, and what we've seen in a lot of companies, is you have to be so concerned about the quarter over quarter. And again, I don't care about the stock market. When people are saying Tim Cook's not an aggressive CEO, they normally say, well, look at the quarterlies. The quarterlies haven't been what, I mean, yes, they're making money, but we're not as impressed as, no. You know, I would really like for Tim Cook to say, I could give a damn what you say about my quarterlies, but we just introduced a new product, and I really think that this is going to change everything. Yeah. Okay. You know what? Let's stop beating a dead apple. Let's move on. What about a little bit of privacy, Lou? Do you like your privacy?
Love my privacy.
Well, you can't have it. Actually, no, you can, according to the Massachusetts Supreme Court. Now, the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court ruled last week, 5-2, that a warrant is necessary for the law enforcement to access your cell phone location data. We've heard stories like this before, where you have a crime committed and the police will go to the telco, go to Verizon, go to Sprint, whatever it might be, and say, can you tell us where this phone was between 9:30 last night and 1 o'clock this morning? That location data can be triangulated because your signal has to hit multiple towers. That's just how signal works. And it looks at a particular ping, finds out exactly how long it took to hit each tower, and they can triangulate your exact position. Now, the decision in Massachusetts was that was based off of a court case about a murder. A woman was murdered and her boyfriend was held as a suspect because the law enforcement accessed cell phone records and found out that he was in the area. He had his lawyer sue, saying it should be non-admissible because law enforcement had not obtained a warrant. Well, back in 1979, the Supreme Court ruled that the government could obtain third-party data from phone companies without a warrant. In other words, and stop me, Lou, if this sounds familiar, they were saying that as long as the government itself isn't collecting the data, that you could go ahead and get yourself the information from Verizon or Sprint if you had probable cause without a warrant. Well, the Supreme Court in Massachusetts had said, look, when that decision came out, technology wasn't as advanced. And now with cell phones, it's not just tapping your phone. We have the ability to monitor your position 24/7. And of course, it's going to require a new law. Here's my thing to you. Everyone thinks that this is horrible because it seems like this guy is now going to get off on a procedural technicality because they accessed it without getting a warrant, even though they previously didn't need a warrant. Is this really a case of technology just not meeting up with the law? Is this, you know, we've heard about this before, but is that what we're seeing here?
I mean, I think that's one aspect of it. I think, everyone has their reasonable expectation of privacy here, but I think this is just more of a deterrent for law enforcement and prosecutors to not, unless they know somebody has committed a crime and then they go to the courts publicly and say, hey, we're pretty sure that this person did a crime, and now we need to kind of fortify that, or we need to make sure we deem it for sure. And so they actually go and ask for a warrant to get the data. I mean, this helps a little bit from that perspective, is, now they have to have proof. But I mean, from our perspective, it's one of those things that's, it's kind of the evolution of products. It's, making sure that, there's things around it that people can't do, to ensure that, we have control more over what we, what we buy and what we do. I mean, people kind of like low-jacking a car, if they can potentially access the data of where your car has been without a warrant. I mean, that to me is a breach of any type of privacy. And that's kind of the same thing as what they're doing, is everyone's got a cell phone today. They have a reasonable expectation that, no matter what they're doing, they're going to have some privacy there without, and hopefully there's going to be some laws surrounding it. And so I think that this is the first step. I can't imagine some of these guys that have gone to jail, some of these people have gone to jail already because of something like this, and what they're thinking about appeals or whatnot, thinking, hey, maybe I can appeal this now that it's actually a law here.
Or as Bean Boy in the chat room has said, hey, if you're going to kill someone, make sure your phone is in airplane mode.
That's right. Burner phones.
Macabre humor, macabre. But okay, but here, I want to ask you this. What are your reasonable expectations of privacy? There's a lot of concerns about what the government's going to be doing with the cell phone, but a cell phone isn't like a landline. When that 1979 law was written, it was all landlines. And that's what we were concerned about, the government being able to walk up to a box and plug in and listen to your phone calls. That required you to actually target an individual who has a reasonable expectation of privacy, that no one's going to be on that line without a warrant. When I'm using any wireless device, be it a cell phone or a Wi-Fi modem or just my laptop with its Wi-Fi card on, I am broadcasting everywhere. You can't hear it, but essentially your device is yelling in the air saying, hey, here's a packet, here's a piece of data, I need something, blah, 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 blah. Do you have a reasonable expectation of privacy if your devices are just spouting RF energy out into the void?
It's kind of like ignorance is bliss, so to speak. I mean, most people don't really realize that that's happening. They think, oh, I have a secure network, or my phone is on a specific provider that they're going to keep all that information safe. I think that there's a reasonable, I mean, most consumers have that understanding, that thought process of, if I'm buying something from a company and they're respectable, they're going to keep my information safe, no matter if it is broadcasting public or not. So I think that that's kind of the key here, is most consumers are not educated about that. I mean, as tech geeks, we understand that things are getting broadcasted, and anybody who wants to listen in potentially pick it up and take it away. But that's not what a normal consumer really understands. And I say, for me, if I'm paying somebody good money for a product that I really enjoy, I kind of expect that to kind of keep my data private. I mean, it goes with any company, whether it's Microsoft or Verizon. I mean, it doesn't really matter. If I'm paying you good money for a good product, it's kind of expected that my data is going to be private, and it's going to be hard for anybody to take that or ask for that data, especially things like location and stuff. So I think it's the first step. It's the next step into where we need to go.
Yeah. Mike the Rhino in the chat room says, that's all true, but you are not intending that data to go to everyone. The intent is that they get the data from one place and that the info they send is intended to go to a single place, regardless of the reality of the broadcasting of data, which is all true. But the thing is, how do we legislate intent? Right? I mean, if I'm standing on a corner and I'm yelling, I killed so-and-so, I can't go into the courtroom and say, oh, I didn't intend all those other people to hear it. I was only yelling at that one guy. It was my accomplice down the street. And intention is fine, but when we start actually talking about reality, I don't know how you could have any expectation of privacy if you are using a device that is just broadcasting. That's just me, but all right. Well, let's move on, because, you know, this, we could go down a rabbit hole with that.
We could, yeah.
Let me ask you this question. Did you have a Walkman when you were a kid?
I have Walkman. I have a mini disc player. I have tons of that stuff.
Did you have a large screen TV? Back then. Yeah. Way back then. Yeah, yeah.
And it's a Sony.
What brand was that?
It's a Sony, man. It's
a Sony. It was always a Sony, yeah. Right? Yeah, I mean, when we were growing up, and I'm going to say we, because you're only like 10 years away from me. When we were growing up, Sony was the brand, was it not? I mean, it was the name in consumer electronics. I mean, of course, there were other brands that made electronics, other brands that made some decent stuff, but it was always agreed that Sony was the master. They were the ones who made the stuff that people wanted, and everyone else made a knockoff. Well, what we're finding now is that Sony is, well, it's no longer the rule of the roost. They're the cautionary tale. We have a story here from Wired about how Sony is actually dropping out of the PC business altogether. This gets the huge sad trombone. Wah, wah. I should probably have that effect loaded into the TriCaster. Now, this story is talking all about how their PC business is now dead and their TVs are next. Two things that used to be huge profit centers for Sony. Two things that used to be huge pieces of cash, you know, little pieces of bling for people who wanted the latest and the greatest, the best and the shiniest. What we've seen in Sony over the years is that they made a bunch of moves that were horrific. The first would be, I'd say, the fact that they had two sides of the company, right? They had the content side and they had the device side, and they were always fighting against each other. The device side wanted to get more content, but the content side wanted to restrict the device. So you got something like the mini disc player, which made nobody happy. A crazy expensive device that was ridiculously locked down that made it difficult for people to play their content that they had purchased in the way that they wanted to play it. You saw it also with, do you remember the rootkit fiasco?
Oh yeah, remember
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
Mark Vucinovich blew that up out of proportion.
That's right, that's right. It was way back when people were starting to rip music off of CDs because they found out that they could. Well, Sony installed a little rootkit in a lot of their CDs that would only run if you put it into a CD-ROM drive, and it would install essentially a virus on your computer that not only would prevent you from ripping, but it reported back to Sony's servers. Yeah, kind of a PR disaster. But even beyond that, it was mostly Sony assuming that people would pay top dollar just because it was Sony, just because they had that 20 years as being at the top of the game. Because they were associated with the premier brand, with the luxury item, they just figured, hey, we're Sony. I mean, where else are you going to go? You're going to buy from them? They're cheap. Well, I bring this up because Sony is not just a company that's on the ropes. They really are a cautionary tale. We've seen this with several companies. We know that this happened to MySpace, although at a greatly reduced timeline. We know I'm sorry about this, but we know what happened to Microsoft. Microsoft got really lazy owning all that market share.
Oh, yeah.
And they just IBM sat too. On it. Yeah, I happened to IBM. It happened to Intel. Intel, for the longest time, figured, well, we're the only game in town. What are you going to do? Until you started getting AMD, you got the A7 processor, you got ARM processors. And I'd argue that's where Apple is right now. I mean, is this just a natural cycle? Do we just see companies sort of implode when they get to the point where it's too dangerous to take a risk because everyone knows them for the luxury item that they are?
I think all companies have that risk. I mean, you know, Microsoft has that risk too. I think Sony, I mean, the problem with Sony is back in the 90s is when they kind of, I think for me, is when they started their downfall from that perspective. I mean, I don't know about you, but I have this, PCs from Sony are basically the bane of my existence back in the day. I mean, they were never made well. I know they were always like the supreme, really high priced devices, but I used to work for a tech company that did service on things like Sony Vaio laptops and Sony desktops. And they were the worst. They never really ever got it right. I mean, they always kind of put it out there as a PC maker, but they were never ever the best. I mean, Compaq Computer always outdid them and all these other companies always outdid them. They never ever did it right. And I think that was kind of the beginning of their downfall. They come out with new things. They're an innovator now, like OLED TV and other things, but they don't actually do anything with it. They're really good at putting out high quality things. So when it comes to like 4K televisions, like the one behind me, I mean, they have just amazing 4K televisions. And, they do a really good job. They were the ones to bring a plasma to the United States. But again, it's like they don't capitalize on what they do. I mean, they come out with a lot of innovation, but they don't push it forward. And I think that's a problem a lot of companies are having today. And I think they need to go back to the drawing board around the company itself and figure out what they need to do to kind of get moving forward.
You know, I think in a lot of ways, this is something that we see almost every week here in the Silicon Valley. This is the startup syndrome. When you are a startup, when you have no legacy, when you don't have to worry about an existing user base, but rather just making a product that knocks everyone's socks off, it's very easy to move quickly. You can pivot. You can change. You could throw your business plan away from the previous week and say, hey, guess what? We're going to do this one because I think it's going to work better. Once you get established, once you get some money in your bank, once you start getting a customer base, it's much more difficult for that to happen. Now, Apple was wonderfully lucky. Both of us are old enough to remember when they crashed. I mean, in the 80s, Apple was dead. It was gone. It was Bill Gates that saved that company. If Bill Gates had not invested that money, Apple would be parted out for its IP. But because they got that investment, they were essentially able to become a startup again. They said, look, we're going to get rid of the old architecture. I know we've been using PowerPC. I know we've been using Motorola chips. Dump them. That's gone. The old operating system, that's gone. The old way of doing business, that's gone. This is a brand new company. All we're going to do is take the name. I mean, you remember that happening, right? Because for a few years there, after that big investment was made, I remember the pundits were saying, oh, that was the worst money Bill Gates has ever spent. That was money down the drain. It was just something to get the DOJ off his back. But it was really Apple saying, throw out what we had been doing. Let's do it over because we don't have to worry about offending our customer base.
Yeah, I remember the day, I actually remember when that happened. And I remember news people saying, you know, they had a competitive company like Microsoft that does software, does hardware like mice and stuff. I mean, it doesn't make any sense for them to do this. And they did it anyways. And I don't know. I don't have any idea what the motivation was behind it. Is to, like you said, maybe to get, you know, the government off their back, saying that they're, you know, a monopoly or something. But they did it. You know, they gave that money and gave the company a second chance. And I think they did what they could for with it, and they did the best they could. A lot of companies have that capability, and you just don't see it enough. Is they get a second chance and they just don't move forward. Like you say, all these startups are kind of like making them look bleak and moving, you know, taking them out.
Little bit sad. But you know what? Let's not dwell on things that are sad. Let's go on to something that's even sadder. Yeah, let's talk a little bit about the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. Have you heard about this act, right?
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah, everyone's heard about the CFAA. The idea is that this is a series of guidelines, a series of laws that were brought together to address crimes in the digital age. It's been criticized a lot because a lot of these laws tend to be overreaching. A lot of them tend to make absolutely no sense. Some of them are even contradictory. But there is actually the right application of the CFAA. Here's a story from the blog, theinternetcases.com. And actually, this was featured on This Week in Law today about a plaintiff who sued a former employee for illegally accessing their network. Now, we hear this a lot. We didn't authorize him or her to access this network. He went ahead and copied a bunch of information, and in this case, used his office email to send that information to his private email, then deleted the receipts off of his email server, so he basically was trying to cover his tracks. Now, the company claimed that the mere fact that he was going into folders that he shouldn't go into, the fact that he had sent proprietary information away from the servers, the fact that they had to research this, they had to actually do forensics to find traces of this, what they called a break-in, was proof of damages. Well, the Supreme Court did not agree. What they said was, unless you can prove damages, some sort of monetary fiscal damage, something that has actually hurt your company, simply someone accessing files that they shouldn't access is not a crime. And they dismissed the case. Now, Lou, I want to get your idea on this. I want to get your take on it, because this is a big thing in the enterprise, right? I mean, when we talk about security,
definitely.
Yeah, we're always talking about locking things down to make sure employees don't get to what they get to. It's always been assumed that with the CFAA, if someone does that, that's something we could charge them with. But here's the court saying, no. Unless you can prove damage, there's no harm, no foul.
This is a slippery slope. I mean, if you think about it, I mean, any corporation out there, I work in enterprise software, any company out there, they have the concept of roles and privileges and only, you know, for your eyes only type things where, you know, you're only seeing data that only your role or your team or your user really should see. And you are signing a contract saying, you know, that this data is private. And all companies have that. I have that with Microsoft. I mean, these types of things is what, when they let you see things, they let you through the gate, that there's a reasonable understanding that that information is private. And so now they're basically saying, unless you can, so I can go steal, now they're saying, I can go steal all that data, I can steal all how the Xbox works and give it to somebody else. And as long as they can't prove that they lost money from it, it doesn't matter if I took it and stole it. And that to me is a slippery slope. Even for startups, that's huge. I mean, somebody who starts up with a company as a partner and then they leave and they go do something else, potentially start something similar, they have to prove, again, damages. Startups don't necessarily make any money. So how are they going to do that? You know, how are they going to prove damages? You know, they're going to say, oh, I have an evaluation off of an idea. I mean, that's not really going to happen. I mean, it's a slippery slope the courts are taking here, and I think it's the wrong direction.
Yeah, that's interesting, because my take was, if you had a million-dollar idea, if you had a process, a procedure, you could sue as IP, stolen IP. But what I'm seeing here is that the courts are saying, look, just the fact that someone accessed a network resource, and it doesn't really state, but I think if you read behind the lines, or between the lines, this wasn't like a hacker. This was an employee who was just clicking around the network, found something that was not secure, wasn't properly secured, and copied files off of it. Well, you can't get in trouble for that, right? I mean, if it's there, if it's accessible, if you didn't do your due diligence to make sure your system is locked down, you have no right to complain when someone accesses a file that they're not supposed to.
I mean, I think the problem is it's a slippery slope. Like, I used to work for a tel company. I was an electrical engineer for one of the mobile companies out there, the big five, the big four. And, you know, there was a customer data was, you know, I could go into the system and download, if I really wanted to, all the customer's data, all the users who ever purchased a cell phone and have a cell phone number. And I could put it on, you know, a spreadsheet and put it on a zip drive, flash drive at the time, zip drive, I think at the time, and take it home if I really wanted to. And how are they, you know, I guess anybody could do that. And then I could go start my own company and then use that as my sales list, right? And go call all those people. And, you know, anybody could potentially do that. And I guess, again, this is one of those things that companies are now being forced to prove that they, you know, these people are, you know, they have to cause damages if they take the data. And I don't know. I mean, if working in a big enterprise company where they lock everything down, you know, it makes sense why they do that, is because you're only really as good as your weakest link. And if there's a weak link in your company that's going to take your data, then, you know, you got to learn to lock it down. And Microsoft's getting really, really good at doing that. Yeah. As they know, you know, they, you know, especially Surface. I didn't even know Surface existed until the day it came out. So, I mean, these are the types of things that companies need to start doing more. And I kind of agree with you in that factor.
Well, you know, regardless of whether or not people are locking down data, there's one thing that I think you and I can agree on, Lou, right? And that's that we love tech.
That's right.
Yeah. So how about this? Why don't we take a look at the tech? Now, Lou, I've been thinking that maybe you should go first. I've got a little something that I want to play with. But you were telling me before the show that you really like, you've got an Asus notebook you showed me a few weeks back, right?
Yeah, love this thing. I mean, have it in front of me right here. It's the UX301 LA. It's got an i7-4558 processor. It's got Gorilla Glass 3. It's nice and smooth. It's got a dual 256 SSD rated 0 in it. 13-inch display, which is 2560 by 1440. It's a WQHD display. It's got 8 gigs of RAM. It's got USB 3. It's got Thunderbolt. It's got a micro SD card. It's got a micro HDMI slot. I mean, it's just ridiculous. The only downfall to it is the 720p camera in the front. Even though it's 720p, like the FaceTime HD camera that the Apple has, it's just not a good camera. But other than that, I mean, the device is just amazing. It's super thin. I don't know if you can see that. And the keyboard, the chiclet backlit, this keyboard is just awesome. And it's probably one of the best devices I've ever owned. I have a MacBook and a MacBook Air. And again, this by far is twice as, maybe, I don't know if it's twice as light or half the weight, but it's definitely lighter than the MacBook Air. Definitely more powerful, quad core i7. So, I mean, I think Asus is doing it right, and they're going to keep getting closer and closer, especially with these new Intel chips coming out soon.
Yeah. I've actually been very impressed with some of the major manufacturers. Acer, Asus, and Dell have all come out with some really nice designs. I've actually got right now running the show is a review unit that I grabbed from Snub's desk. It's a Dell Precision, I think, 8300. This thing has a 3850 by 1800 display. It's ridiculous.
Wow.
It weighs about 4 pounds, i7 processor. It's got all the ports all around, touchscreen, et cetera, and it's just nice. It doesn't remind me of a Dell laptop. It's got a nice matte finish. It's got a rubberized keyboard. It's one of these things where, why didn't you have this thing 5 years ago?
Right. Well, they're private now, right?
You're private, yeah, exactly. Right. So now they can do stuff like this, and of course, everyone knows that my personal favorite notebook right now is the Acer S7. That's my ultrabook of choice.
The second generation one, right?
Oh no, I'm on the third generation.
The new one
has a 2560 by 1440.
A 1440, display. Yeah, oh, exactly, yeah. Nice. It's the way to go.
But here's something. I actually want to get your opinion on this. I'm looking at this Dell Precision 3800. It's nice. It's nice. Pricey. But nice. And I'm thinking, I've seen the 2560 display. I'm not seeing a whole lot of difference between that and the 3840. I mean, mentally, I know that the resolution is better, but I'm not seeing like an increase of quality that makes me go, oh yeah, definitely. I saw that when I went from 1366 by 720 up to a true 1080p screen. I saw that when I went from a 1080p screen to 2560. I'm not seeing that in the next jump up. Is this just going to be another one of those things where we say, more pixels because they want the specs?
Yeah, I think getting any higher than 2560 is kind of a gimmick almost. So because you're getting to that point where people are not going to be able to see the pixel density at all. And if you think about it, that's why you're not going to see any 4K displays at that size, that small size, because it's just not useful. You know, it's not, I mean, I'll tell you one thing, that the quality of the text, it's just amazing. It's sharp and crisp. But, again, going any higher, it's not going to really work out. And also, I mean, I try to connect to work with this at this resolution using remote desktop. And, you know, I have a pretty good connection here. And at that resolution, it's actually kind of tough. It's a little jittery here and there because it's such a high resolution trying to pull so much data from my PC at work. For the screen, it's tough. So I don't think people are going to be using it that much unless things better compression and stuff happens. So I think it's more of a gimmick. I think as the higher they go.
Yeah, that's actually one of the things that I was concerned about, which is at 3840, you're kind of you're just fighting against yourself now because you've equipped your computer with more pixels than it should have at that size of a screen, and all you're doing is taxing the graphics chip, right? I mean, that sounds kind of silly.
It really is. I mean, it's funny because I've been waiting for a Windows laptop to get to that resolution, 2560 at the very least. And the S7 just this year came out with a model. And again, Asus just this year. I was waiting for Christmas time, and they just came out with it. I mean, Apple's been there for a while now, and it was killing me that I had this big bulky MacBook that I had to cover to walk around with when I could have an ultrabook. And I've been waiting and just waiting. They finally came out. And now they're trying to go beyond that limit as if, again, to say, hey, we can go even beyond this, even these little tiny thin devices. And I think, again, it's just a gimmick. It's just a sales pitch for me, at least.
Yeah. I mean, there is a discernible increase in quality on some of these screens. But for most of them, you're not going to see it. Now, yesterday, I was at the house and I was showing off my new S7 to some of the brothers. And telling them that I love this notebook, you know, it lasts 12 hours on a battery, it's thin, it's light, it's actually less expensive than an Air. And one of my Jesuit brothers who has a MacBook Air was saying, "Oh, but it doesn't have a Retina display." And I was like,
"It's better than a Retina display."
I was like, "Do you know what that means? I mean, do you actually understand, or did you just get that from the marketing?" And it's funny. I think Apple, some Apple fans inherited some of the worst traits from PC fans from the longest time. Which I remember when we would have these stupid spec fights. And Apple, Steve Jobs rightly said at one point, "I don't care what the specs are. I'm not selling you specs. I'm selling you a product." But all right, let's get again. I think I'm showing my anti-Apple bias. I wanted to show off a little something. People who have been watching me on Before You Buy know this thing. This is a device that I've been playing with for a while. This is called a BioLite stove. Now, the idea is really simple. It uses a thermocouple to be able to capture some of that heat, drive a blower, which increases the heat of the stove, increases the heat of the fire, and then in turn generates electricity that you can use to charge a device. Very useful little device, and I thought maybe you should take a look.
Part furnace, part cooking tool, and part power generator, the BioLite Camp Stove is a 2-pound forced air biomass burning portable cooking stove with a thermopile twist. Wrapped in its own carrying case, the stove is comprised of two pieces, the combustion chamber and the power unit, the latter of which fits snugly into the former for easy packing. The combustion chamber is a double-walled steel cylinder surrounded by a honeycomb lattice that allows you to pick up the stove even when it's hot. It has three fold-up legs at the bottom of the unit to give the stove stability while in use. A large vent in the back allows air to be forced into the chamber to increase the efficiency of the burn, and a port at the top of the chamber is the entry point for the heat exchanger. The power unit is a high-impact plastic shell surrounding a heat exchanger and thermopile assembly, battery, and blower. The probe transfers heat from the combustion chamber to the thermopile, which generates electricity to run a fan that forces air into the combustion chamber, generating a hotter flame, which in turn can generate more power. The front of the power unit has a single button to turn the fan on and off, and a silicone-covered USB port that can give the internal battery an initial charge, and, well, that's the twist. The power unit attaches to the back of the combustion chamber and is held in place by a locking mechanism activated by the third support leg. Once assembled, the BioLite Camp Stove is a stable platform that can be used as a heat source or, with the included triangular cooking attachment, can support kettles, pans, and other cookware. BioLite also offers a 2.5-pound portable grill for those who want a more even heat source for grilling. Two foldable legs support the grill on top of the BioLite, and a closable flap allows for easy refueling. To use the BioLite Camp Stove, you loosely fill the combustion chamber with dry fuel, light, wait 10 seconds, then push the power button to activate the blower. The blower forces more air into the combustion chamber, which allows for a more complete, almost smokeless burn and a hotter flame. We used this flame to boil a liter of water in under 5 minutes, and the forced air combustion chamber meant that it was possible to burn biomass that doesn't easily burn, things like cherry pits and walnut shells. As the flame gets hotter, the heat exchanger generates more power, eventually generating more power than is required by the blower. Once this point is reached, the status light at the front of the unit turns green, which means it's now ready to provide that excess power to attached USB devices. To be sure, the excess power isn't a lot. It's rated for a max of 2 watts of 5-volt power. In 15 minutes of burning, I added perhaps 5% of charge to my phone, but it definitely provided USB-compatible charging. A more suitable setup would be to charge a small USB battery that could then be used to power your USB devices. Aside from the hotter flame and USB charging, the power unit adds one more advantage to the BioLite Camp Stove. At the end of the burn, the fan will continue to blow, burning all the embers down into cold ash, stopping automatically once it's safe. In fact, I was able to pour the ash out of the combustion chamber onto a paper plate with no fire, no embers, and no mess. In all, the BioLite Camp Stove is an innovative product that should appeal to outdoor enthusiasts, geeks in the wild, and those who just want one more power source in the event of the zombie apocalypse. The BioLite Camp Stove is available online and at outdoor stores for $130. The portable grill will add $60.
I took this
stove. That is awesome.
It's a really cool little device. I took it with me down to Brazil because for 6 weeks I was living in some strange places, and I broke this thing out more than once, And it became a lifesaver because I was in the middle of nowhere. There was no grid power. And between that and a small solar cell that I had carried, it kept my device charged enough so that I could call out to whoever I needed to. Yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah.
It's a cool little thing. I saw it a few years back as a maker project. Or no, it was an Indiegogo project. The company originally wanted to supply these things to third world countries so that they could boil water. The whole idea is you want people to have clean water. The problem is a lot of these nations have already burned up all the readily consumable, readily combustible fuel. And so they needed something that could burn what would typically be non-combustible. Well, you can do that if you have that blower to create sort of that furnace effect. Not bad.
It's great for hikers if they're going up to the mountains and they want to, you know, obviously it gets colder up there, so they need a heat source, but they also want to be able to charge their cameras and stuff. So it seems like it would be a useful thing for even them, especially.
Yeah. Oh, and one more thing I do have to say. Yes, for the people who wonder why my voice is like this when I do reviews, it's because I do voiceover afterwards, and it's difficult for me to express my excitement. All right, well, Lou, I'm sorry, but I think we've reached the end of Padre's Corner. I want to thank you for hanging out with me.
I
have to say, I'm getting a little worried because you're seen on the Twit Network an awful lot.
I'm just following suit, man. Just following suit.
Have you been on the Sunday show yet? Have you been on Twit?
No, I haven't.
Okay, when you get on that show, then I have to start watching behind my back. But for the folks at home, can you please tell them where they can find you? Tell them where your work can be seen.
Yeah. So find me on Twitter, Lou MM. And also, I work for Microsoft. I work on a product called Dynamics CRM. It's a customer relationship management software. You can find that at crm.dynamics.com. And we're working on bringing it to more devices near you. So look out for it.
I like that, bringing it into more devices. Now, Lou, I'm going to have to invite you back. You are still on Coding 101. You're still our code warrior. And people really should check out that show if they get a chance. That's Coding 101 every Thursday at 1:30 p.m. Pacific time. Also, you can find me on my other shows. I've got a couple of shows on the Twit TV network. You can find me on Mondays at 2:30 p.m. Pacific time for This Week in Enterprise Tech. We typically talk about things that are affecting those enterprise folks, people who maybe work in information technology. It's a fun jaunt with a bunch of true geeks. Also, right before Coding 101, you can find me doing Know How with Cranky Hippo, Brian Burnett. That show goes off at 12:30 p.m. Pacific time. We're also going to be adding a couple of shows to the Twit schedule. Please stay tuned for that. There's a lot of exciting things going on in the Brick House. Now, Lou, one last word, if you want to say goodbye to the folks. Do you want to give them a hint on maybe what they're going to be talking about on Coding 101 next week?
Yeah, come check out. You know, we obviously did the menu system last week, so go check that out for sure in the last episode. But we're going to be talking about potentially a little bit of object-oriented stuff and some properties, maybe some other things, building software that's manageable, I guess you could basically say. So look out for that.
I love it. Folks, I'm afraid that's the end of our time here. I want to thank everyone who made this show possible, for everyone who watched it live, for everyone who's going to watch it on our YouTube channel. Be sure to check out our YouTube channel. You can actually find us at youtube.com/PadreSJ. Also, you can find me on my other YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/GadgetsTTS. So GadgetsTTS. This is the channel that I used to do when I was still working beyond Twit. I had a lot of reviews. You could find a lot of the old gadgets that I used to put through the ringer. Just figure out how I got my start on Twit. It was pretty much this channel. It's something that I really, really appreciate. Special thanks to Leo and Lisa for letting me do this on the Twit stream. And till next time, just remember, this was Padre's Corner.